Good morning. How are you all? Did you have a nice breakfast? I think some of our people are still getting some nutrition. We're nothing if not healthy. So good morning, everyone. I wanted to come up here this morning to reiterate my comments of yesterday about the fact that we're all here to talk about how we're going to implement the Affordable Care Act, an act that had just passed last year when we got together for the first time. Our partner back then and our partner today was the Office of Minority Health. And I really want to acknowledge the Office of Minority Health and the Department of Health and Human Services in being such a strong partner to NCLR as we have all worked our way through this law. And we have all looked at what our role is in it. And we all now come together to figure out how we go back and implement it in the best way. We are so grateful to you in the audience. Already I've heard people talking about what their follow-up is going to be when they go back. On the way down here, Maria Pesqueda caught my ear, and she already is bringing Illinois and California together. So y'all have a challenge out there. But this really is about our next steps. And the Office of Minority Health, Dr. Nadine Gracia, who will be introduced formally in a while, the head of that office, has been one of the strongest partners that you can imagine, not only in the spirit of implementing this law, but in providing very critical financial support for this summit to come together. And so, as we move forward and listen to our speakers today, I hope you will be thinking through what kinds of questions we might have for them that will further our work. And more importantly, I hope you will be catching on to each of their phrases and how that's going to play out at home. So I have the honor of introducing the real introducer this morning. The real introducer this morning is Lori Bautista, who is the director of policy at the Tiburcio Vazquez Health Center in the Bay Area of California. I think it's fitting that our panelists be introduced by someone in the field who is carrying out this law. And so I turn this over to Lori. Thank you, Lori.
Good morning, and thank you very much, Dahlia. I'm honored to be here from the sunny state of California. This is actually my first time to New Orleans, and it's been a wonderful conference and summit so far, and I look forward to this morning's presentations. All of us here today who work in the field of healthcare in any aspect are aware of the critical importance of the social determinants of health, the health of our patients, the health of our community, and overall population health of our nation. We are therefore pleased to have several learned speakers this morning to discuss Latinos and the Affordable Care Act. And three of them are from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. These leaders will be discussing how the nation is addressing health disparities, cultural competence, and civil rights protection through the Affordable Care Act. And they will provide an update on the health insurance marketplace and its impact on the Latino community. And those of us who are working directly with residents of the Latino community back home in our cities and towns, in our rural areas, in our urban areas, are well aware of the need for outreach and education as we move forward into 2014. I'm so honored to introduce our first speaker, Dr. J. Nadine Gracia. Dr. Gracia is the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Minority Health and the Director of the Office of Minority Health at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Now, in the interest of time, she very graciously said that we didn't need to read her entire bio, but it is distinguished, and I am going to kindly disagree with her just a little bit and read some of her great accomplishments. From 2010 to 2011, Dr. Gracia was the Chief Medical Officer for the Health and Human Service Office of the Assistant Secretary for Health, where she provided programmatic and policy leadership and coordination of a portfolio that included child and adolescent health, climate change, disaster preparedness, environmental health, global health, Haiti Recovery, and the White House Council on Women and Girls. Most recently, she led the development of the Health and Human Service Department's 2012 Environmental Justice Strategy, which addresses the disproportionate exposure of minority and low-income communities and Indian tribes to environmental hazards and promote healthy community environments. In 2008 and 2009, Dr. Gracia was one of 14 White House fellows and was assigned to the Department of Health and Human Services, where she worked in the OASH office, which is the Office of Assistant Secretary for Health, and the Office of the Secretary. During the last 2 months of this fellowship, she was a policy advisor in the Office of the First Lady, assisting in the development of the Childhood Obesity Initiative. Previously, Dr. Gracia was a clinical instructor and general pediatrics research fellow at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, conducting research on community risk factors for violence. She received an MS in clinical epidemiology from the University of Pennsylvania and an MD from the University of Pittsburgh School of Medicine. Well, that's our panel presentation for today, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. what a distinguished career, and what an honor it is to have Dr. Gracia joining us. In addition to Dr. Gracia, we have Myra Alvarez, Director of Public Health Policy in the Office of Health Reform at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Gina Rodriguez, Latino Affairs Liaison, Immediate Office of the Secretary, Office of Intergovernmental and External Affairs, U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, and Carol McDonald, Director of Strategic Partnerships for Planned Parenthood Federation of America. Lastly, we have Alejandro Gepp, Associate Director of the Institute for Hispanic Health at the National Council of La Raza. So we'd like to get started this morning again to discuss the issues of health disparities and cultural competence. I'm sure you will be very interested in what they all have to offer us today. And with that, I will introduce Dr. Gracia. Dr. Gracia.
Good morning. Thank you, Lori, for that very kind introduction, and thank you all for coming out today for such an important discussion on the Affordable Care Act and the Latino community, a discussion on health disparities and cultural competency. It's really a pleasure for me and my colleagues from the Department of Health and Human Services, Mayra Alvarez and Gina Rodriguez, as well as our co-panelists, to be here with all of you today. I had the pleasure of speaking at last year's NCLR Health Town Hall, and what I remember most is the passion that was in the room, the excitement as we looked to the opportunities ahead, the enthusiasm of the discussion, the remarkable sense of commitment that resonated from every community leader that I spoke to and every advocate that I met. Like many of you, I come to this conference with a deeply personal commitment to the issues that are being discussed here. From equity to access to opportunity. As the daughter of immigrants, I have seen firsthand how deeply these issues and these questions matter in our country. My parents came to the United States from Haiti, where they were both educators. My mother was an elementary school teacher, and my father was a principal. And they came to the United States because they believed America to be a nation of opportunity unlike any other. And in that belief, they found the courage to leave everything that was familiar to them and start anew. When they came to the United States, my mother's first job was as a live-in nanny, and my father painted boats for $1.75 an hour. And they showed my siblings and me truly the value and the sacrifice that they had made for us, and truly instilled in us the values of perseverance, of diligence, and hard work. You know, in a country that was founded, in the words of President Obama, on the idea that anyone from anywhere can write the next great chapter of our story, I know that my family's story is not only the story that we see, it's not the most and only unique story. I know that many of you here today can tell the stories that share common threads with mine. It is, I think, a fundamentally American idea that even though each of our stories begins differently, there are ways in which they all come together, ways in which they can't help but be bound together. And the only way to move forward is to rise as one, as the theme of this year's conference so boldly declares. Nowhere is this more true than our health, one of the most important things that any one of us has, no matter where we come from, no matter what language we speak, no matter what our means. And nowhere is that more evident than our healthcare system. At the most basic level, health is opportunity. Health is the freedom to pursue your dreams and fulfill your potential. And when some among us don't have the opportunity to reach our full potential for health, that truly weakens us all. And so that's why the persistence of disparities in health and health care is so alarming. For far too long, Latinos in our country have been less likely to get the preventive care that they need to stay healthy, less likely to receive quality care when they do get sick, and more likely to face poor health outcomes. You know these statistics. Nearly one-third of Latinos live without health insurance, the highest uninsured rates of any racial and ethnic group in our country. The consequences have been high. Latinos have higher rates of chronic conditions such as diabetes and obesity. They're more likely than non-Hispanic whites to suffer from certain types of cancer, such as cervical cancer. And they often face worse outcomes than others who receive the same diagnosis. And there is diversity within the Latino community. The diversity that we see, certainly when we look at health conditions, such as higher rates of obesity among Mexican Americans, or when we look at rates of childhood asthma and see higher rates of childhood asthma among Puerto Rican children. We also know that all too often, Latinos have trouble finding a doctor or finding a doctor that they can talk to. Too many in the community have struggled to achieve good health because the healthcare and services that are available to them do not adequately address their needs. Yet we know that it's not only our healthcare system as it has existed that presents a challenge. It's also the social determinants of health, as you heard earlier this morning, the places where people live, learn, work, where our children play. Latinos often live in places with far less access to healthy foods and where it's hard to find places to engage in physical activity safely and conveniently, where these social determinants of health are truly stacked against them. I remember hearing the challenges from my patients as a pediatrician, from my patients and their parents who would talk about the challenges of being able to find those healthy foods for their children, the concerns they had for their safety of their children in their neighborhoods. For far too long, Latino families have struggled to overcome these and other barriers to health. But let me be clear. The health of Latinos and the disparities that affect Latino communities are not just a concern for the Latino community. These issues are not just a priority for NCLR. In the words of the civil rights leader, Cesar Chavez, society is made up of groups. And as long as the smaller groups do not have the same rights and the same protections as others, it is not going to work. The health disparities faced by Latinos and other minorities have exacted a tremendous cost on our country as a whole. Whether we measure it in terms of the economic cost, where studies have shown that the cost of health disparities and premature death exceed $1 trillion, or whether we look at it in the context of the American promise of equality, opportunity, and justice. And unless they are addressed, these inequities will shape our shared future as a nation. Today, one out of every six people in America is Hispanic. One in every four American children is Hispanic. And by 2050, nearly one-third of the American workforce will be Hispanic. Nowhere is that growth more vividly illustrated than right here in New Orleans, a city that might historically be better known for the French Quarter, but today is home to a vibrant and surging Latino population. In cities and towns all over the country, the words of President Obama ring true that our American family will only be as strong as our growing Latino community. At the Office of Minority Health, our work is dedicated to ensuring that all communities have the opportunity to reach their full potential. Our mission is to improve the health of minority populations by developing programs and policies that will help to eliminate health disparities, from support of the important work to promote promotores de salud, to programs that help to address disparities in childhood obesity, diabetes, and heart disease, to support for our partners like NCLR. In these efforts and everything that we do, our work is dedicated to the pursuit of health equity, the attainment of the highest level of health for all people. And from that vantage point, what we see is a remarkable moment of opportunity for those communities that have long faced the greatest challenges. 3 years ago, when President Obama signed the Affordable Care Act into law, it opened an unprecedented window of opportunity to advance health equity. Those of you who played a part in the passage of the law, you can speak to the journey it took for us to get there. from the doubts and debates about aiming too high or thinking too big. But as the implementation of the Affordable Care Act continues, we can step back and recognize all that it represents. And as you will hear from Myra and from Gina, it is already making a tremendous difference, especially for the communities that need it most. It truly represents an historic opportunity, an unprecedented step forward for equality, an opportunity that most of us may see only once or twice in our lifetimes, as has said our Secretary of Health and Human Services, Kathleen Sebelius. Taken as a whole, the Affordable Care Act represents one of the most powerful pieces of legislation to help reduce health disparities. But we recognize that it isn't enough to initiate a transformation. And that's why, under the leadership of Secretary Sebelius, we charge every agency in our department with working to reduce health disparities. That's the mission behind our department's first ever action plan to reduce racial and ethnic health disparities. It means that we take health equity into consideration when we make decisions about our programs and our policies. It establishes strategic areas of focus, from transforming healthcare to enhancing the diversity and cultural competency of our workforce, to investing in community-based programs, and it's also holding us accountable in meeting each of these goals. That includes initiatives such as our department's Promotoras de Salud initiative to recognize the important contributions that promotores make in their communities and to promote their increased engagement as trusted leaders in health and education in underserved Latino communities. And it is through this initiative that the Office of Minority Health has awarded funds to NCLR to do this type of scan and capacity building to train promotores to provide nutrition and physical activity education to Latino families. We're also drawing on new tools and new technologies to improve care for those who have often been dismissed as too hard to reach. Just this spring, we announced the winners of a mobile app challenge, a challenge where we asked entrepreneurs to help us develop an application for mobile devices like smartphones to be able to provide information on preventive services and screenings, treatment and referrals for women who are at high risk or who have been diagnosed with breast or gynecologic cancers like cervical cancer, which certainly has a disproportionate rate in the Latino community. These are some of the types of innovative efforts that we have to really work towards addressing health disparities. And recently, just this April, we announced updated national standards for culturally and linguistically appropriate services in health and healthcare, also known as the CLASS standards. Through the CLASS standards, we are working to strengthen our efforts to help Americans have access to services that are respectful, responsive, and effective at every point of contact. We know that language barriers and cultural differences often present a challenge to receiving care, a challenge that I've experienced in my own family. Far too many times when I've gone to the hospital to see a loved one and been asked to be the translator for a family member, when all I could think about was praying for them, holding their hand, being there to support them, but yet had to test and be there to translate and provide information for them at a critical time of need. The importance of quality care should never be lost in translation. And we are working with our partners across the country so that no matter what language you speak, you have access to the care and services that you need. As our nation changes, our approach to health and healthcare must evolve too. In the face of changing demographics and a healthcare system that's undergoing a remarkable transformation, cultural and linguistic competency may be just one of the most important levers that we have for advancing health equity and improving care. The CLASS standards are grounded in a definition of culture that is as dynamic as this nation is itself, acknowledging that our health beliefs and practices are influenced by race, ethnicity, language, and also socioeconomic status, religion, spirituality, disability status, and geography, whether we come from rural or urban communities. We also are drawing on a broad definition of health, a holistic perspective that includes not just our physical well-being, but also our social, our spiritual, and mental well-being. Each of these initiatives, from the CLASS standards to the innovations such as mobile apps, focuses on a different area for improvement, a different lever for progress. But what they all have in common is the recognition that no single individual, no single sector can solve and eliminate health disparities alone. And this is just the beginning. As you'll hear from this panel, starting this October, the opening of the new health insurance marketplace will introduce a whole new way for people to shop for affordable health coverage where they live, millions who will have access to gain coverage, and Latinos are among those who stand to benefit greatly. But we recognize that expanding coverage isn't the same as getting people enrolled and connected to care if they don't know about it. And so as the implementation of the Affordable Care Act continues, our charge truly is to press ahead, to keep the momentum going, to make the most of this remarkable moment of opportunity. And whether we rise to meet it, whether we can look back years from now, recognizing that we face such an important opportunity for change to turn the chapter on health disparities, it depends not just on us in Washington, D.C., not just on us in the federal government, but on all of us, on committed advocates and engaged organizations all across the country. As community leaders, activists, and advocates of all kinds, we ask you to partner with us in this historic effort. Yours is the leadership we need. Yours are the trusted voices out in the community that we need. That is the strength and the history of NCLR, which traces its origins to the civil rights movements of the 1960s. Rise as one. For all that our efforts and our roots may differ, our stories have common threads. Our journeys are shared. Let us work together so that our families truly have the opportunity to live healthy lives. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gracia, not only for that very concise and informative policy overview, but for sharing with us your personal stories, for giving us a glimpse into reminding all of us that healthcare is so very personal. Our next speaker is Myra Alvarez. She is the Director of Public Health Policy in the Office of Health Reform at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, where she has primary oversight responsibility for coordinated and timely implementation of the public health prevention and healthcare workforce policy provisions in the Affordable Care Act. Quite a big job. Please help me in welcoming Ms. Alvarez. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for having me here today. It's an honor to be with everyone who is working on healthcare issues, committed to healthcare issues, and ensuring that we have a healthier Latino population and a healthier country moving forward. This is the second year that National Council La Raza has hosted a Latino Health Summit in advance of its annual conference. And it really is a testament to the leadership of NCLR to be on top of the issues facing the Latino community. In NCLR's quest to advocate for the civil rights of Latinos across the U.S., you fought for a simple goal that's at the heart of the American dream: equal opportunity for all people, no matter their background or their heritage. And you can't have opportunity, good opportunity, without good health. A child who isn't protected against the measles or chickenpox is going to miss school and fall behind her peers. Parents who can't get treatment for their chronic disease are going to miss work and be passed up for promotions. Young people who have a stack of unpaid medical bills will have a hard time pursuing their dreams. If we want to give every Latino, every American, a chance to reach their full potential, we need to start with improving health. As Dr. Gracia explained, one of the single biggest steps we can take to improve opportunity for Latinos is to reduce health disparities. And that's what the Obama administration has been doing for the last 3 years since the Affordable Care Act was signed into law. Over the last 3 years, implementation of the law has built on what works in our healthcare system and aimed to fix what's broken by focusing on four key areas. First, creating new common sense rules of the road for insurance companies, so you know your insurance will be there when you need it the most. Second, taking steps to drive down costs for families and small business owners in the private insurance market. Third, strengthening our Medicare program for the 50 million people that are on the program today, but for the millions of us that want to depend on it tomorrow. And finally, ensuring we have better options for coverage and better access to healthcare services in our communities. Today, because of the law, close to 1 million Latino young adults have gained insurance through their parents' plan, because the law requires insurance companies to allow children to stay on their parents' coverage until the age of 26. 3.9 million Latinos with Medicare received a free preventive service, such as a flu vaccine or a diabetes screening and an annual wellness visit. Many saved an average of $700 last year on the cost of their prescription drugs. 8.2 million Latinos who have private insurance today gained improved coverage for preventive services, not only removing financial barriers like cost-sharing requirements, their $40 copay or 20% co-insurance rate, but ensuring that their plan actually has coverage of critical services like contraception, breastfeeding supplies, and other critical preventive services to stay healthy. About 10 million Latinos no longer have to worry about going without treatment for cancer or other chronic diseases because of lifetime dollar limits. No longer can insurance companies cap the amount of coverage for your plan, so you know that if you're diagnosed with a serious illness and the cost of treatment adds up, your insurance will be there, like you expected it to be. And we have made these changes while saving costs to individual Americans, but also to the system at large. We've seen the slowest sustained national health spending growth in 50 years. $2.1 billion has been returned to consumers through medical loss ratio rebates. Yesterday, the president applauded these accomplishments at a White House event. I hope many of you had the opportunity to hear him say important remarks about the work we're doing, but also about the new efforts we have to control rate increases by insurance companies. While we do see insurance company rates continuing to rise, they're actually going up at a slower rate. And in some states across the country, they're actually going down. $4.2 billion was recovered in 2012 from anti-fraud efforts in Medicare, a record high, for a total of nearly $15 billion over the last 4 years, double that of the previous 4 years. For the 85% of Americans that have insurance, that's what the Affordable Care Act is about, strengthening their coverage and building on what works. All of these changes help reassure Latinos and all Americans that have insurance that it will be there when they need it. But let's be clear, the law is also fixing what's broken. And what we know is broken is the fact that 50 million people across this country do not have access to health insurance. 50 million people, including 10 million eligible Latinos, do not have the peace of mind that insurance will cover their care if there's an unexpected diagnosis or a serious car accident. Millions of families worry about taking care of their kids or their aging parents. I know I worry. One of those 50 million people is my baby sister, Alejandra. Today, Alejandra is 20 years old. She works at In-N-Out Burger in El Cajon, California, right outside of San Diego. And I can tell you, she cannot afford insurance. To be honest, I don't think she's ever even thought twice about it until the day she needed it. In order to complete her coursework to become a patient care technician, she needed to have a checkup and some shots to ensure she was healthy enough to be around patients. I'm proud to say that Alejandra graduated from her program in June with high honors. We gave her a stethoscope engraved with a special message for her so she can be prepared. But she also graduated having paid $300 out of her pocket for that checkup and some shots that could have been free had she had insurance. The Affordable Care Act is about Alejandra and the millions of others that we know we have to reach to ensure they have the opportunity for coverage available to them. And that opportunity will be possible starting this October with the health insurance marketplace. When we ask the 15% of Americans why they don't have insurance, the answer is not generally because they don't want it. It's because the process is confusing or overwhelming. It's because it's too expensive. It's because the very services that they need, insurance companies could carve out and not cover for them. Or they've had frustrating experiences in the past, and they just would rather not try anymore. This is how the marketplace will help. First, it's an easier way to shop for health insurance. The marketplace simplifies the search for health insurance by placing all of your options in one place. It's for individuals and small employers to directly compare their private health insurance options, known as qualified health plans, on the basis of price, of quality, and of other factors. It's one application, one time, and an individual or family can explore every qualified insurance plan in their area. Eligible consumers will not be turned away because of a pre-existing condition like HIV or diabetes, and people will have clear options with apple-to-apples comparisons. All the health insurance plans in the marketplace will present their price and benefit information in simple terms people can understand. Second, most people will be able to get a break on costs. We estimate that 90% of people who are currently uninsured will qualify for discounted or free health insurance if we assume that every state expands Medicaid. Competition in the marketplace will help bring down costs, but there will also be opportunities to make sure that we educate Americans about the importance of the expansion of Medicaid. And finally, number three, there is assistance available to help consumers get the best coverage for their needs, but only if we work together. Today, I'm going to discuss a little bit of each of these points in more detail and look forward to this panel discussion as an opportunity to learn more about what we can be doing together. So first, regardless of the state you live, you'll have access to the health insurance marketplace. Since the law was passed, we worked with states to prepare for 2014. Each state had the option to choose between a state-based marketplace, where states create and run their own marketplace, a state partnership marketplace, where state partners with us, the federal government, to run some of the functions, or finally, a federally facilitated marketplace, where the state has a marketplace established, but it's operated by the federal government. In every state, people will have access to the marketplace that offers these qualified health plans. These plans will be available, and they've agreed to follow certain rules. Like I said, not turning anyone away because of a pre-existing condition, not charging older Americans 10 times more than young Americans, but also to offer a comprehensive package of services known as essential health benefits. The law directs that these benefits be equal in scope to the benefits covered by a typical employer and cover at least the general 10 categories: ambulatory patient services, emergency care, hospitalization, mental health and substance use disorder services, preventive care, lab services. Every plan will cover the essential services we need to get or stay healthy. And in every state, the eligibility for the marketplace is the same. In order to be eligible, you have to live in the marketplace's service area. You have to be a U.S. citizen or national, or a non-citizen who's lawfully present in the country, and you can't be incarcerated. Also, across the country, for the first year, the marketplace initial open enrollment period starts October 1st and ends March 31st, 2014. This means we're less than 75 days away from new opportunities for coverage for millions of Americans. And it's not only for individuals and families, but also for small businesses who buy their own insurance. The SHOP, or the Small Business Health Options Program, is a marketplace for small businesses and their employees in order to help give small businesses the same advantages of large businesses. Prior to the Affordable Care Act, a small corner store paid an average of 18% more for health insurance coverage than the commercial chain store down the street. It wasn't fair. By participating in the SHOP, eligible employers can benefit from economies of scale and new protections that help them get real value for their consumers' premium dollars. In addition, employers will define how much they'll contribute toward their employees' coverage and have exclusive access to a small business tax credit that we've made available for small businesses since 2010. It'll cover up to half of the cost of health insurance coverage. For individuals, the options available for health insurance coverage are also easier to understand. For many of our most vulnerable in states across the country, there will be new access to Medicaid. Because of the Affordable Care Act, states have the option to expand Medicaid eligibility to adults ages 19 to 64 with incomes up to about 133% of the federal poverty level. That's about $15,000 for an individual and about $31,000 for a family of four. And it's important to note that this is a great financial deal for states. For the first 3 years, they'll receive 100% federal funding for the cost of the newly Medicaid eligible. And after that, the federal government will support at least 90% of the cost. States have no deadline to decide if they're going to expand, and we're more than willing to have that conversation when they're ready. For those individuals that will not qualify for Medicaid and who still need some financial help for getting insurance coverage, the new premium discount will be available through the marketplace that helps reduce costs right away. People who qualify can take the premium discount in the form of advance payments to lower their monthly marketplace health plan premium starting in 2014, which can help make insurance more affordable. Unlike other tax credits, a payment will go directly to their insurance company. When you apply, you'll provide your household income, identification to show that you're in the U.S. legally, and other information. That premium discount is generally available to individuals and families with incomes between 100% and 400% of poverty, between $23,000 and $94,000 for a family of four. There will also be cost-sharing reductions. The out-of-pocket cost will even be lower for some families. To be eligible, you must have a household income that is less than or equal to 250% of the poverty level, about $58,000 for a family of four, as well as enroll in a certain level plan, a silver level plan in the marketplace. But there's also a third option for coverage for individuals and families. It's the Alejandra option in my mind. The marketplace will also have affordable options for coverage called catastrophic plans. These plans are intended for young adults under 30 years of age or for those who can't afford coverage and get a hardship waiver from the marketplace. These plans generally have high deductibles and lower premiums, but also include coverage of 3 primary care visits, as well as preventive services with no out-of-pocket cost. It's intended to protect consumers from high out-of-pocket costs, because really, we are all one serious diagnosis or car accident away from bankruptcy or a lifetime of hurt. So the various options for coverage that are available indicate that there's an expectation that most Americans will have health insurance. If you don't have health coverage, you may have to make a payment when you file your 2014 federal income tax return in 2015 and thereafter. But I think it's important to note that there is a variety of reasons you may get an exemption from this responsibility requirement. There's reasons like religious conscience, certain federally recognized tribes. If you don't file taxes, if your income is below that minimum threshold, there's no responsibility requirement. If you're incarcerated, as I mentioned, and also if you're not lawfully present. With more people with insurance, we all benefit. For years, people with insurance pay for the uninsured in greater premiums, what's known as the hidden tax. We pay an average of $1,000 more in premiums to cover the cost of uncompensated care in our communities. This is an opportunity to level the playing field for all of us, those of us with insurance and those of us without. And as I mentioned, getting coverage will be simplified. Beginning this October, the new marketplace, as well as Medicaid and CHIP programs, will use a single streamlined application to determine eligibility for enrollment. There will be a seamless process for consumers. You'll be able to apply online, by phone, by mail, or in person. You'll submit that single streamlined application to the marketplace. The application will be verified by our data services hub, and your eligibility is determined for either the marketplace, for Medicaid, for CHIP. The consumer will allow the system to determine that eligibility based on their requirements, and then that person can enroll in the program you're eligible for. Now, we recognize that the process will be brand new to people. And yes, this is a challenge we all need to prepare for. And we've started doing just that. At the end of June, we relaunched our website, healthcare.gov. The website, which Gina will walk you through next, presents key information about the healthcare law and how we can help people best prepare for the open enrollment period. The website has everything from information on the marketplace and checklists to get people ready, but also basic explanations of terms like what's a deductible or what's a copay. And the website is available entirely in Spanish at cuidadodesalud.gov. In addition, we launched a toll-free call center available in Spanish and English and with the capacity to assist in 150 additional languages. And just like many people prefer to apply online or by phone or by mail, others want to apply in person. So recently, we announced $150 million to support outreach and enrollment in community health centers across the country. Latinos represent 1 in every 3 patients that goes to a health center in this country. Investing in these trusted resources is critical. We awarded about $32 million in grants for efforts to identify and enroll children eligible for Medicaid and CHIP. Funds went to state agencies, health centers, school-based organizations, and nonprofit groups to engage schools in outreach and enrollment, to reach out to children who are less likely to have health coverage, like Latino kids, streamline enrollment for people in public benefit programs, and improve application assistance. And we did so knowing that efforts to enroll children can also help efforts to enroll parents if there are options for parents available. And with the marketplace, that's going to be available for parents. Soon, we will announce recipients of funds to become navigators across the country. I'm sure many of you are familiar, but navigators are organizations and coalitions of organizations to help people through the process of enrolling and using health insurance. Community-based organizations, agents and brokers, other third-party assisters like certified application counselors will also play a critical role in helping people apply for health insurance coverage. And we're working now to ensure our partners across the country are ready. Because the goals of the Affordable Care Act will never be realized if the people that need to hear this information don't. So I want to make sure that you all are aware of a key website for partners, which is marketplace.cms.gov. On this website, you can find educational resources like drop-in articles, PowerPoints, talking points, and fact sheets. You can learn how to partner with us and what those roles for navigators and certified application counselors are expected to do. You can see our schedule for trainings, currently educational webinars, but in the future, details about trainings for those interested in assisting people with enrollment. We know that we, the federal government, will not be able to do this alone. We know that many people are not personally connected to the federal government or know of a government website. but they're likely connected to their church, their health center, their community center, or their YMCA. Our partnerships with organizations across this country is critical, and we are hopeful that we share a goal of ensuring more Latinos, more Americans have access to health insurance and the care they need to live a healthy life and thrive. While we know there's more that needs to be done, we could all use a bigger budget. We are maximizing every opportunity. I thank you immensely for the help that you've given us to get us to this point. We know we would not be here without you, but I also thank you for your partnership in the work to come. We are definitely not done yet. So with that, I'll turn it over to Gina for our walkthrough of our great website, Cuidado de Salud, or healthcare.gov.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. So as Myra mentioned, soon we're gonna have the possibility on October 1st to have the open enrollment. And so in that, with that in mind, and also having in mind how important our partners are in this endeavor, we have revised the healthcare.gov website and the Cuidado de Salud website as well. And soon we'll be able to realize the full promise of the healthcare law when millions of Americans and can come to our website and enroll. Individuals and families and small businesses will be able to find health insurance options that meet their specific needs. Starting on October 1st, it'll be open, but now is really the time to be ready. And the best source to be able to obtain these updates is in healthcare.gov. And everything that we will go through in our walkthrough is correspondingly available in Spanish at cuidadodesalud.gov. So now, because having this in mind, we've tailored it so that you can see a lot of the different resources that we have available for our partners. So, there we go. It's back here. Let's see. Yeah, let me see if I can just do page down. Okay, oh, so there's a slight lag, that's right. Okay, so I wanted to point out some of the links that, I'm just gonna go through and show you quickly. So, okay, so there's a small lag in the refreshing, but we'll just keep going. So the new content that we've added, and we're gonna continue to update, is to kind of help you to find the resources that are available, and we're adding new content and simple language, and it's with you in mind that we have made these changes. So this website is built in responsive design so that no matter what mobile device a consumer chooses to access the site, it will be appropriately displayed, like via a smartphone, tablet, laptop, or a desktop computer. And the website will be integrated with our new toll-free call center, and we have a web chat available and in 24/7 in English and Spanish. And consumers can also call the 1-800 number and speak with trained customer service representatives 24 hours a day. And also, the representatives will be available in 150 languages. So let me give you a little bit more detail. So from this homepage, we have the two tabs. We have where you can sign up for updates. So you can enter your email here and then sign up to obtain additional updates. And we also have the Start Now button, which is just a little bit up higher. But I wanted to point out here in this link for in the website for partners that we have a lot of resources that you can access so that you can obtain Spanish publications, brochures, fact sheets, drop-in articles, materials that are tailored to Latinos, infographics, publications, and link to the product ordering website. So here under the official resources, you'll be able to obtain a lot of materials and widgets that you can add to your websites And so you can have access to the latest materials that we're using as well. And you can when you can also order additional Spanish language materials by creating an account at the product ordering website. Okay, that's fine. So I just wanted to highlight that there are two tabs here where you can learn, and then if you're an individual or a family, you can go through here, or if you're a small business, you go here. And so I can go through and try, let's see if this will work, to do an example. Okay, and then, so in the green button, we go to the start now, and then, so we put in a profile, and this is how someone can start to get ready for insurance. And so if you're looking for coverage for yourself and for your family, okay. Okay, so right now, if you go through and punch in all of the things that are applicable to you, you'll be able to generate a checklist of what you need to be ready that is applicable to you. And you enter your state, and it will give you what the options are that are available in your state and where consumers can go and get insurance. In the Get Insurance tab is what will where people will actually go in come October. And in this this one will go live in October 1st. They'll be able to create their accounts on this tab and access the single streamlined application that Myra mentioned. And we'll also provide a whole range of helpful hints throughout the process. And you'll always have this for questions live chat option at the bottom. And thanks to the marketplace, for the very first time, consumers will be able to go to one place to search for coverage options, and they'll be able to see it in an easy way, easy to understand way, and have comprehensive information, and be able to access all the different health plans that are applicable to them, and be ready to go when coverage starts. So no matter where consumers live, they only need to fill out the single streamlined application on marketplace. And that is available to them, and then they'll be able to learn to see what programs they'll qualify for, and that includes the Medicaid or CHIP, or find out what best meets their needs, depending if they're like single and what kind of premiums they'll have. So it'll be great to finally be able to see all of the different options that are available to you in your particular market. So the resources that we'll have is just, this is just one example of the different steps that we're taking to ensure that Americans could take full advantage of what we have and what we've been working on to make sure that you know that that we'll be ready to go come October 1st. So as we kick off our enrollment efforts, we'll be distributing the funds to community health centers, and as Myra mentioned, they recently went out, and we'll be able to partner with you. So I want to make sure that you are aware of all of our different ways that you can engage with us. So in addition to all of the resources that I showed you, when you click on partners, you'll be able to be linked into different places to order your own materials, whatever, depending on if it's English or Spanish, and also other ways that we can partner. If you're not already receiving the HHS Latino updates, I want to get your business card and add you to the listserv so that you can always be apprised of all of the new updates and funding opportunities that we may have. And just stay connected on an ongoing basis. And sometimes people think that if they don't have a health-related community-based organizations, that they might not, this might not apply to them. But there are so many ways that you can help, because the individuals that are coming through your community-based organizations are exactly the individuals that should be learning about this. So ways that you can help are also by putting posters about healthcare.gov in your offices, brochures and fact sheets. We're happy to host webinars for your staff and for your organizations. And we also have a lot of content and messages and drop-in articles and all of that that you can use. And you can also, if you are interested, we have the content for you to do PSAs at the local level and just, you know, helping us, particularly with regard to, like, social media, to amplify the message so that everyone is aware and ready and knows where to go when it's time to enroll. So we have, with that in mind, and knowing how Latinos are using, really taking advantage of social media, we have recently created a new handle on cuidadosalud.gov, on Twitter, and in Facebook, too. We have cuidadosalud.gov also on Facebook, but on Twitter we also have at HHS Latino, and we're just trying to find all the different ways to make sure that you know that you have an open door at HHS. And if you're interested in receiving the updates, the ongoing updates, please be sure to leave me your business card or your email, and I'll be happy to add you so that you're apprised of all of our new and upcoming things. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Gina. We apologize for those technical glitches. It's the vagaries of the modern age we live in. I'd like to introduce next Carol McDonald, who, as we previously mentioned, is the Director of Strategic Partnerships for Planned Parenthood Federation of America, where she leads a constituency outreach team that focuses on communities of color, works to deepen relationships with national coalition partners, and establishes new relationships with groups and individuals. Please help me welcome Ms. McDonald.
All right. Thank you so much. I am so honored to be here. First of all, this panel, I am humbled, so I hope that I can live up to my colleagues here on the stage. But also, again, I want to acknowledge both NCLR's leadership in talking about healthcare and being really at the forefront of that, and also making the space to talk about women's health. And I'm really going to focus my comments on women in particular, and Latina women specifically. So I've been at Planned Parenthood for 9 years, and I've been a community organizer basically my whole life. And for those of us who care about equity and justice and who are doing social justice work and are in the civil rights arena, I think that generally the political process for us is disappointing, and we are used to losing our battles and often being frustrating. So it is even that much more exciting to me to be here in front of you to talk about the benefits of the Affordable Care Act, because I truly believe that it is a victory like no other that we will see in our lifetime, an opportunity for us to not just make a real difference in people's lives, but really transform our communities. And also, I mean, I know a lot of you come from organizations. It also is a chance to build organizations. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that as well. I have to click. Here we go. All right. The four things that I would like for you to walk away with from this presentation today is to really help you understand why Planned Parenthood specifically is engaged in educating communities about the Affordable Care Act. What does this mean for Latinos specifically, and particularly Latina women? We've done a tremendous amount of research, and we're actually, it's still ongoing. We just finished doing a series of focus groups in Los Angeles, New York, Houston, Texas, and Columbus, Ohio. And we're using that to inform our public awareness campaign that we'll also talk about. And I really want to share with you the lessons learned from that research and how that is informing our ongoing research. So in terms of women specifically, there are, of the 50 million people that are going to be eligible for coverage, 12 million, there are going to be 12 million uninsured eligible women that are of reproductive age, so between the ages of 18 and 40. What we have found in our work is that there's a significant lack of awareness among these women that anything is even coming. So folks know that there's a new healthcare law. folks know that sometimes it's called Obamacare. But other than that, we have a long way to go to like connect people to from that awareness to how to actually access the benefits that have been talked about previously. October 1st, right now, at least for the women that we've been talking with, they don't know that that's a date out there that they need to pay attention to. And there's also a lot of confusion around, you know, what that means for them specifically. For us as Planned Parenthood, and again, I'll talk a little bit about why I think that we're so uniquely positioned to communicate to women in general and Latinos specifically. But there's just not a whole lot of knowledge out there about all the wonderful things that are going to be available to them. So in terms of targeting specific audiences, again, we are focused on women's health. And so for Planned Parenthood, why I want to talk a little bit about why specifically we are a credible messenger. So across the country, we run 750 health centers. All across the United States, we have a presence in every single state in terms of a health center, with the exception of North Dakota, working on that one. But we are everywhere else. We see 3 million patients in those health centers every year. Half of the patients that we see are uninsured and eligible for coverage under the ACA. So that is tremendous. That's 1.5 million people that currently are not insured that are walking through our doors every day. Of the 3 million patients that we see, 24% are Latino, and that number continues to increase each and every year. And people are often surprised when I say that a quarter of our patients are Latino, but it is one of our fastest growing patient populations. We also see 1 million people in our health education programs. You know, Planned Parenthood, we are not just a provider of healthcare, but we are also an educator, and we are in communities throughout the country providing health education. And on our healthcare website, plannedparenthood.org, we have 4 million unique visits to our website every month. That number continues to astonish me. I've been in this organization for 9 years when we barely had a website. So to see the tremendous growth of people looking to access health information online, it is really, really incredible. And the one thing that I also want to point out that I think is important in terms of educating people about the Affordable Care Act, I mean, the success of the ACA is going to depend on not just people enrolling, but having a nice, healthy mix of folks who are younger and healthier, as well as those with that have more illness. And one of the things that we do with Planned Parenthood is we keep people healthy. People come to us for a variety of different services. More than 90% of what we do are preventative services. We offer, you know, birth control and access to contraceptives. We offer pregnancy testing and counseling. We offer testing and treatment for STIs. And we are one of the largest testers of HIV in the country. So this is definitely a tremendous opportunity for us. Again, one of the things that we've learned from our initial focus groups and the focus groups that I mentioned, we literally just completed those a few weeks ago. But a couple of things that we learned are that women in particular, they want to know the facts about the new law. When you approach them about the new law, they're very interested, they're very excited, they don't know anything, but they definitely don't want to be sold on something. They really want just the facts. And the most important facts that we have found are obviously that starting on October 1st, that they can start applying and enrolling in the marketplace. That the new insurance plans cover things that they care about. And for the women particularly that walk into our health centers, that is obviously access to birth control, also access to hospitals and ER visits, that they can get coverage for a pregnancy. And it also covers doctor's visits and prescriptions. Like Myra referenced before, it's important for us to highlight that there is financial assistance available to make sure that that plans are affordable and that you cannot be denied coverage due to pre-existing conditions. So how are we going to do this? at Planned Parenthood, we just came away from training 250 of our operations and public affairs staff just last week. And it's literally the first time that we were able to roll out the findings of our initial research just internally. So this is actually the first time that we are sharing it to an external audience. So you're a little bit of my guinea pig. And I definitely look forward to hearing both your feedback on what we've learned and any questions that you have as we go along. Again, we also have trained educators across the country, including hundreds of promotores in several different communities. We will be creating collateral materials. I'll preview some of them here for you. Again, you're going to be some of the first folks outside of Planned Parenthood to see them. We'll use the vast reach of our website, as well as our social media properties and our call centers. All right. So, literally, and I gave Myra just earlier today a copy of our first flyer that we've created for our new public awareness campaign, which is Get Ready to Get Covered. And all of our materials for the first time in any campaign that we've ever run will be available in both English and Spanish, every single thing that we do. The other piece of our research that I really want to highlight, so we know that in order to reach large numbers of people, we're going to have to really take advantage of our call centers, our health centers where our patients come and visit us, as well as the internet and social media. But it's also really important with a process like this, where you have a long education curve, that we talk to people one-on-one. So just a few weeks ago, we also piloted Canvas projects. We did one in Dallas and another one in Detroit. The one in Dallas, we knocked almost 30,000 doors and had over 11,000 conversations with people exactly about the healthcare law. We targeted folks who that we thought would be eligible for coverage. And we also, the other ask that we are layering on top of our canvases, so we're not just educating them about the law, we're asking them to sign up to be a supporter of Planned Parenthood, and we are also registering them to vote on the doors. And I think that's a really critical component that we are adding onto our program that I would love to see replicated throughout the country, is that voter registration piece, because the way that we got this victory and we got this law was through civic engagement and demand from the people, and we're going to need to continue that to make sure that this law is successful and that we also have other victories for our communities. That's a long ask. That's a long script for people on the door. And when I talk about the Detroit project, we even had a fourth ask. And you know, again, as an organizer, this made me very nervous. It's like, is this really going to work? But we had over a third of the folks that we talked to on the doors in Dallas complete all the steps and take the actions that we asked of them. So it takes an investment. It is a long conversation, but we are seeing tremendous successes, and we're really learning a lot about how to talk to folks about the benefit. In Detroit, we knocked on over 46,000 doors. We had about 9,000 conversations at the doors. And here we really got to test the enrollment piece because Michigan has a program where folks can apply for can be enrolled into the Family Planning Waiver Program, which is basically a way for them to get discounted access to reproductive health care. So we actually kind of had something like ACA, you know, so the process really similar. Again, we enrolled people at the door. We said, we have this card, you can sign up, we think you're eligible, and we have presumptive eligibility there. So we were able to actually enroll people into a health care program, as well as then, would you like to be a supporter of Planned Parenthood and hear more about the issues that we're facing in your state legislature? And then also, again, and are you registered to vote? If not, we have the form right here with you, and please complete that. And we had even greater success in Detroit, where two-thirds of the folks that we talked to and engaged on the doors actually completed all the steps. So it's very, very exciting. This is a copy of the materials that we used in Houston, and again, we are letting people know that you might be eligible for health insurance. Let me, under the new healthcare law, let us talk to you a little bit about what that looks like and what you will need to do later on. We have them fill out a card so that we continue to follow up with them. And then we also asked them to register to vote. And all of, again, all of our materials are English and Spanish. And this was actually in the three neighborhoods that we canvassed in Texas, too, where we're heavily Spanish-speaking. We had bilingual canvassers. All of our canvassers are bilingual. So what are some of the things that we've learned? Again, like this is, people are very interested and excited about this. They just don't know. So that education piece, it's a long process, but it's totally, it's so super critical that we're out here talking to folks about that. In order to be able to be impactful and scale up, it does really take an investment. And we sort of did these pilots on our own, but we would love to expand that, and we would love to work with both national and local partners on the ground to see if we can scale this up. It does take a heavy investment in training and working with staff on the ground. I think, I like to do a little organizer math, and what it came down to for us, that for every person that we signed up, the cost is about $20. I cannot highlight enough, and again, I put this in bold red, that this is such a tremendous organizing opportunity. Again, it is about the benefit in educating people about the law, but it is also about building capacity for our organizations. It is also about building our political power, and it's also about engaging people in the political process. So that voter registration piece, I cannot talk enough about that. And it is definitely a conversation. It is hard to boil this down into little sound bites. What we found is that we sometimes have to start the conversation with talking about the new healthcare law, which is sometimes also called Obamacare, to get really people really comfortable with the concept. And then after that, we can kind of go to the shorthand. So that was my quick and dirty version, and I'll be around later if you have any questions.
Thank you so much, Carol. We're going to go straight to Alejandra Gipp now. Most of you, of course, know Alejandra very well as Associate Director of National Council of Rosas Institute for Hispanic Health. One quick note for all of you. As all of you know, we are going down to January 2014, very fast and furious. This is a very complicated and exciting time for Affordable Health Care Act. And as such, we are going to be foregoing our break and barreling right into the question and answer period after Alejandra's comments. So I just wanted you to be aware of that and start getting your questions ready. Thank you. Alejandra?
That is a very smooth transition to say, be short and be concise. I will try. Okay, so for those of you who don't know me yet, I'm Alejandra Jett. I work in the programmatic part of NCLR, which is the Institute for Hispanic Health. And I want to make this distinction because NCL is very well known for the work, our health policy work does, and advocacy work that is done around the different initiatives. So the NCLR, Institute for Hispanic Health, focus on the development and implementation of health education and health promotion programs that are implemented through community-based organizations. In short, all the organizations that are present here, and most of our work is done through community health workers or promotores de salud. So having said that, as you saw yesterday, through the survey conducted in conjunction with GSI, our organizations are preparing to enroll in the Affordable Care Act. We also saw that organizations confront multiple barriers. And here at NCLR and the Institute for Hispanic Health, we are constantly assessing and reassessing what is happening in the field so that we can meet the needs of all of you, our affiliates, our community-based organization. Oops, I didn't realize I was there. Manuela did a really good job yesterday explaining about some of the barriers our affiliates are currently confronting. There are issues around language, immigration, documentation, lack of outreach, and so forth. So the question we are asking ourselves is, how do we meet these needs? How do we reach out to Doña Juana, who sells pupusas in the corner, so that she can take advantage of what Obamacare is and be fully insured? So, in these presentations, I'm going to talk about four specific initiatives. One of them is establishing partnerships, how we go about raising awareness about the importance of culturally competent outreach efforts, how we seek funding, and how we provide assistance to our affiliates. The representatives of what you see in this table is a really good representation of how we go about in terms of establishing partnerships. We have worked day in and day out with the Department of Health and Human Services, with the Centers for Disease Control, with the Centers for Medicare, and other nonprofit organizations such as AARP, academia, and other nonprofit organizations. As I've traveled around the country, I'm always asking myself, how can I reach out to someone in a culturally competent manner? And so that, as I mentioned earlier, so this, the person can take advantage of the benefits Obamacare is providing. So one of our goals is to participate. We've been participating in coalitions focused on supporting navigators or navigation efforts. As you saw yesterday, we have collected data around ACI through quality research. And that has given us a clearer picture of how we can tailor our efforts among CVOs and community health centers. How can we address myths and misconceptions? And what are the community needs? In terms of myths and misconceptions, our communities are largely uninformed about how the law would apply to them. But also, the media can be very powerful, but also there's been things out there, there are things out there that people has taken it as something that is real. For example, in one of the webinars, actually Gina was facilitating, maybe it was CMS with Teresa Nino. One participant asked if why Obamacare was going to put them the la marca, the mark. And Teresa Nino, I think it was Teresa, said, yeah, you know, I'm sorry, I don't know where that came from, but long story short, they were referring, something about the Obamacare is that people, all people need to be insured, and we would like to be, to every single person to be insured. And the speculation is that if they don't get insurance, they are going to put a chip to track them down. And it's real. The good news about these type of questions And, you know, kudos to CMS and to HHS because they've been working aggressively through these webinars to encourage people to ask questions. And people are asking these questions. So us who are providers can address this. Long story short, I did research where that particular myth came from, and when the Obamacare was being developed, there was something about tracking people with a pacemaker and blah, blah, blah. And somehow, you know, people understood that, some people, not everyone, that they were going to have La Marca and other way, and that the government was going to track them down. So my job and the job of my colleagues is to go to the field and address these myths and misconceptions, and how we go about that is we take advantage of every single project we have in all the different states to address some of these things. For example, at the beginning of August, I'm going to attend the Binational Conference of Promotores de Salud. And if you really want to go to a very good conference, I highly recommend that you go to that. It's all in Spanish. And even for someone like me who's been doing this work for over 15 years, I find it incredibly powerful and empowering. Because it's the exchange of ideas between Promotores de Salud in Mexico and the United States. And it's organized by the Health Initiatives of the Americas. And it's a really good one. So in this presentation, or in that presentation, what I'm planning to do is to address some of these myths and misconceptions and encourage people to ask questions, not to be afraid. Their role, each of our federally qualified health centers and community health organizations are going to play is crucial, or are already playing, is absolutely crucial. More than one here is going to tell me, Alejandra, we need funding to do this. Absolutely, we need to we need to have funding to do this. And our senior vice president for programs, Delia Pompa, is sitting at the front. And yes, we work aggressively in reaching out to different partners so that we can secure funds to do outreach and education around healthcare enrollment and implementation. The government, HHS, CMS, have released several funding opportunities, and although we would like to apply and to respond to some of those opportunities, sometimes we really don't have the capacity to do it. But some of you have done a very good job in applying, and in those cases, we provide technical assistance, and that is another way that we respond to some of the needs. And lastly but not least, what you see on the screen is a list of our 15 federally qualified health centers who recently received funding from HRSA, and congratulations to all of them. Thank you.
Thank you, Alejandra. I just wanted to take a quick personal moment and mention that we're very proud to be on that panel for Tiburcio Vasquez Health Center, having received the HRSA funding. I can assure all the HRSA members up here with HHS today, we will make excellent use of that money, and we are excited to be doing outreach and education. I think one of the things Alejandra mentioned was something we could all relate to, was the number of myths and misconceptions and misunderstanding about the great opportunities we have with the Affordable Care Act, and it's really important to clarify them as we go forth and educate people about this new law. We have about 23 and a half minutes to go straight to questions and answers. If you have comments, feel free to mention what's on your mind as well. We do have a wireless mic that will be available to the audience, and we will bring it around to you. If you'll just raise your hand, we will flag you down and make sure that your voice is heard. A quick note, if there is any press in the room, we're asking that you please hold your questions until after this panel concludes, and NCLR will connect you with the right people that you need to get to. So with that, I'd like to start. If anyone has a quick question or a comment, we're happy to take questions now. We have a mic for you.
Maria Pesqueira from Mujeres Latinas en Acción in Chicago. First of all, thank you, NCLR, for putting this panel together and bringing us together in the caliber of the folks that are up there. I just wanted to comment on Planned Parenthood's, that model is a model that is used definitely by women in the community, right? So I have Doña Chuy next to me who's saying, wow, that's what we do. We are knocking on doors, voter registration, but at the same time, we get them information on this, on these other topics. So I also heard Alejandra mention Doña Juana on the corner and getting information to her. But Doña Juana on the corner selling pupusas is the perfect person to help us get other folks signed up. So not only do we want to get the information to her, we want to bring her along. And so the topic that I think we're getting at is the very much needed resources to help a Doña Juana as she's helping us knock on those doors and get the information out. So I would continue to urge for all of us to look at finding resources to make it possible for those folks on the ground.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Valentina Stackel. I'm from Farmworker Justice in Washington, D.C. Thank you so much for your presentation. It was, as always, very informative. My question is, in the last couple of days, I've been talking to a lot of people, and everybody's sort of saying the same thing. We're developing materials, we're developing curriculum for promotores de salud to get the information out there. I feel like we're all developing similar materials, and we're all working on the same things. Is there a plan or is there a place we can go to sort of collect all of the materials that people on the ground are making so that we don't keep, putting in money and time and effort for the same thing if there's already stuff out there?
So we briefly mentioned this, but the primary website for our partner organizations is partnership?
No,
Marketplace. Marketplace.cms.gov. And on that website are our materials, PowerPoint presentations, fact sheets, drop-in articles that organizations can then tailor to best meet the needs of their specific groups. There are specific tabs, for example, on research so that you can actually target, look at your state down to your community level, who's uninsured, what are the demographics of that population, so you can get the best information to target those materials. I definitely understand and appreciate the need to be able to share resources. One of the areas where we really needed assistance was in translation of Asian languages. We just didn't have the resources at the federal government. But with support from Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, we were able to partner with the Asian American Health Forum, and they were able to translate a number of materials into different Asian languages. So absolutely, I think maximizing our partnerships and leveraging those resources will take us a long way.
Gil Ojeda, University of California, UC Berkeley School of Public Health. In California, we've had an exchange going on for 18 months. Going through an immensely complicated process to develop exchange that reaches everyone. And one of the sub-themes in California is if it doesn't work for Latinos, it's not going to work for anybody. Now, that said, U.S. or the federal government has now assumed responsibility for this exchange in over 30 states. And there's a lot of Latinos in those states. And it's not clear, for instance, whether the process in those states has been designed and has been rigorous enough to be able to reach all those underserved populations, particularly since the states, in many cases, have simply walked away, and the feds have had to step in and do their job. So the question is, how is the federal government engaging to ensure the essential diversity in the population, in the provider community, that's going to be needed in critical states like Texas, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, North Carolina, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera?
Yeah, I'll start, but my colleagues can definitely add on. You are absolutely correct. We estimate that 1 in 3 people that are eligible for coverage in the marketplace live in 3 states, California, Texas, and Florida. And those are key states for the Latino population. So we are well aware of the importance of ensuring that we reach the Latino community to ensure that they're prepared to enroll come October, but that they're actually informed of this opportunity and what health insurance can mean to their well-being and long-term success in this country. To be honest, we are very excited about California and the work that they're doing and the leadership that they've taken to start up Covered California and engage with Latino organizations and support from the California Endowment to make that march as strong as it can. And we're doing our best for Texas and Florida and for all of the other states that we're operating the federally facilitated marketplace. Conversations like this are key to our work moving forward, to inform our partners, to engage our partners, to get our partners excited about this opportunity and know the resources that we do have available on marketplace.cms.gov, but actually also through the Office of Minority Health, through each of our agencies that are all tasked with making this a top priority moving forward. I can't tell you that we have the same level of resources as California. They're definitely focused on their constituents. We are more focused on the nation at large and the states where we're running the show, like you said. But I do think we can learn valuable lessons from what California is doing on the ground. For example, different efforts that they've done that they've seen successful, can we apply that or support those efforts in other states? It's those types of dialogues that we know we need to engage in order to be successful moving forward.
The only thing that I would add is with the Navigator grants that went out, we had a stipulation in there that they had to have language access and be culturally competent. And then when they are awarded, we're going to begin doing the training, and the training will have those kinds of components as well. And so even if some organizations do not receive a Navigator grant, there other people in local community can still be trained to be in-person assisters, and that's where you're going to be very key, like where if they can go into your organizations and enroll people there, and that would be really helpful. But that's where we're going to rely also heavily on our partners, and we hope that you will be willing to partner with us as well.
I got a quick question, Ricardo Cortez from Texas. And more for Carol, because I saw that we're about over 18,000 doors that, you know, you have meaningful conversations about the ACA. My question is, of those 18,000, do you have a number of how many were Hispanics or Latinos, and of the action takers, how many were Latinos, and if the language was a barrier, and why some of them didn't take any action into it?
So I will say that our Detroit pilot was primarily an African-American neighborhood. So, but in Dallas, so of the 3 neighborhoods that we canvassed, 2 were in Latino communities, and then 1 neighborhood was an all-white community. And I will tell you this, that is a neighborhood where we got run out of town. Like, that was where we were, where we encountered the most resistance and were the least successful. We did not find a language to be a barrier, because all of our canvassers came from the community and were bilingual, and that was something that we ensured up front. Having said that, we did have a slightly lower response rate in the Dallas canvas that we did than we did in Detroit. Some of that I think had to do with familiarity with us as an organization, just the level of comfort and familiarity with us at the door. We have been in Detroit much longer, and it's just a different. It's been historically been a different environment for us. For us than Dallas. So I think that there are some lessons learned coming out of, and literally, I mean, we came out of this, I want to say, 2 weeks ago. So we're still digging through exactly what it is that we could improve upon in our in our Dallas work. But I would say that initially language, at least the language was not a barrier, at least into having the conversation. But I do appreciate your question about did that impact people's decision to engage with us. I will also say the one thing that was challenging about the Houston pilot is we didn't actually have a product to offer people. So it was really more about like sharing information about what's to come. And then, oh, by the way, sign up on our list and register to vote. In Detroit, we actually had a product to enroll people in and benefit that we could give them right at the doors. And actually, that is one of the things that made our Detroit pilot extremely successful. People were like, oh, what? I can get my birth control for free by signing up in this card? Yeah, I'm in. So I think that had a lot to do with our success in Detroit.
I guess my subsequent question is probably more for the panelists on the HHS is the... Texas have a highly, you know, we have one of the highest uninsured populations in the United States, and our governor decided not to take on the expansion, so we're going to leave a lot of money on the table that is going to be available on the next 3 years for many of the other states that aren't going to do that. I guess my question is, are there any plans from the department, HHS, on how they're going to tackle this community, specifically when we're looking at San Antonio, we're looking at the Valley, which we have a predominant Hispanic community, and if we don't, like if we saw in the Dallas and in the Detroit area, where, you know, we didn't have a high participation of the Hispanics, how are we going to ensure that some of these people that probably don't have access to the internet, probably don't have access to other means of media communication, that they're gonna need somebody to knock on the door? What is the federal government planning to do to ensure that these people are going to be able to enroll or at least know what are their options? Because this is going to be critical in the next 6 months for our Texas community, especially the uninsured Hispanic community.
I'll start, and certainly others, Myra and Gina, may have some other comments. One is that I can talk about is the importance of the partnerships. Our department, as I mentioned in my remarks, launched a Promotores de Salud initiative, and we have very strong networks of promotores in the state of Texas who are doing outreach and education on the Affordable Care Act. They have made this a top priority that they recognize being out in the community and really sharing information, providing resources is one of the great ways that they are able to really help promote health in their communities. And so similarly, the trainings we've talked about, the information and sharing of resources, we are working with those types of strategic partners to really ensure that we're getting the messages out. And that's through churches, that's through another partnership that was recently announced with the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, was with the Institute of Museums and Libraries. Where public libraries taking on the mantle to actually be able to have information about the healthcare law, about the marketplace, and also being able to help people with not only understanding it, but also facilitating enrollment. So it's utilizing those different types of partners out in the community who are there every day, each and every day, to really share that message and connect people to getting more information and then being able to facilitate enrollment as well.
The only thing I will add to that is that obviously, you know, Medicaid is a state-federal partnership program. The federal government, HHS, continues to be ready to have conversations with states across the country that are still weighing the options when it comes to the Medicaid expansion. As you know, there are billions of dollars on the table for states who are in very tight fiscal climates and whose budgets are already struggling. So we know that those conversations may come later and we'll be ready for them. But it's important to note that of the uninsured in Texas, about half are actually tax credit eligible, 100 to 400% of poverty. So as we're struggling, you know, to make sure that more states take on the Medicaid expansion option, there are millions of people that will qualify for tax credits in order to afford health insurance coverage. And we should also focus our efforts on making sure that they know this information and are ready.
And I will also say, I think that's for me why for those of us who are community organizations, why the voter registration piece is so important, because in those states where governors have decided for whatever reasons that they're not going to take the Medicaid expansion, they need to hear from the people who are impacted, and those people who are impacted are traditionally more disenfranchised, right? So it's our responsibility to make sure that people are aware, that people are aware of the benefit, both what they're eligible for and what's being left on the table for whatever reasons, and that we have to activate those folks and say, yeah, let your governor know that this is something that now you know, and now you know, now you want, and let's put some pressure there, because we are really hurting people by having these governors not take the Medicaid expansion.
Good morning. My name is Claudia Barajas, and I'm with the Latino Community Agency in Oklahoma. I would like to thank NCLR for this wonderful panel. Great information. I'm from Oklahoma, and as you know, Oklahoma was one of those special states that did not accept these changes. Last April, the Latino Community Agency decided to submit an application for the Marketplace Navigator, so hopefully we'll hear positive from that. But my question is, because Oklahoma did not accept these changes, there haven't been any changes regarding to health coverage for the communities. What options of health coverage am I going to offer to the community if we receive the grant? How are we going to, what options are we going to provide? Because after I submit the grant application or we submit the grant application, I decide to call and do a test and see, searching the internet, looking for the health coverage options for the people. I type all my basic information about a quote, trying to get a quote for health insurance. And I have been receiving at least 20 or 30 calls for health insurance companies throughout the United States offering me a health coverage. And I, when I ask them, do you speak Spanish? I probably get to the point that I will not be able to speak English to you. Do you speak Spanish? No, we don't speak Spanish because the majority of the people speak English. So we don't have any option for you. So I have been concerned about that because, first of all, we need to really identify what options of health coverage we have to give the people in Oklahoma. And second of all, people is going to be bombarded with all the health coverage options, and we don't know how to control that, or how, what can we do to control that, no?
So Oklahoma is one of the states in which the federal government will operate the health insurance marketplace. So come October 1st, Oklahoma will be just like California, Texas, Florida, Massachusetts. You will have a health insurance marketplace open to constituents of Oklahoma that are eligible for coverage on the marketplace. So for individuals generally above 100% of poverty, there'll be some options for coverage available through the marketplace. Good luck on the Navigator application. Obviously, we're gonna announce those awards in mid-August, and that's not my area, so I'm glad I don't have to share those details. But regardless of what happens with the Navigator Awards, because that's $54 million, we're going to need every organization that connects with the community to be certified application counselors. So still go through the training to still understand how to operate the marketplace, how to answer these questions. Because you're right, people are going to be overwhelmed. Many of these people have no concept of health insurance, don't understand the idea of paying for a premium and a deductible and co-pays. And we're going to have to do some basic education. And frankly, they're not going to be coming to the federal government for that education. They're going to be going to you, to organizations they're familiar with, to people that they trust. So we want to make sure you have that training available to yourself. But come October 1st, you will have a health insurance marketplace where health insurance plans will compete for business. Health insurance companies want people on their rolls, especially young and healthy people. And thankfully, there are millions of young and healthy people out there, many in the state of Oklahoma, who don't have health insurance today because the process is confusing or it's expensive. And the marketplace is going to create that opportunity to simplify that process, not only giving advantages to insurance companies who want more customers, but giving advantages to people who actually want options for coverage. So stay in contact with us. Let us know how we can be helpful moving forward to October. But be confident that come October 1st and you go to healthcare.gov and you click I'm from Oklahoma, there will be options for coverage available.
Thank you. We do have time for just a few more questions. I want to make sure I'm getting to everybody. It's a little hard to see through the lights at the back, so if we do have some people in the middle to the rear of the room, please raise your hands high, and we'll try to get to you before the end. And with that, I think we do have one more question.
My name is Cecilia Roberto, and I'm with Pfizer and the State Government Relations team. I have a question that kind of dovetails on her question regarding the availability of services in states. I think one of the things that comes to mind in the federally funded or the federal exchange states like Texas and Florida, being that there is a significant Latino population, I think that the format of the door-to-door activity that Carol mentioned, I think is very meaningful and very impactful. My concern is what steps are in place to protect people from people taking advantage of that kind of activity, insurance companies going and misrepresenting themselves or only selling their particular product and not really being a navigator on behalf of the exchanges themselves. Like, what mechanism is in place to protect that? Because I think the Latino community at large is very vulnerable to that. When I look at Texas and I think of communities like the Valley, like El Paso, that are 90% Latino, who desperately need these services and have the need for the information, what is in place to prevent that aspect of this opportunity?
Yeah, absolutely. We couldn't agree with you more. And that's a concern we've heard time and time again as we do these webinars and conference calls, particularly with the Latino community. Concerns about personally identifiable information are not only in the Latino community, but Americans at large. And for the different in-person assistance programs, there are different security agreements that we'll have. So for the Navigator programs, it's a cooperative agreement between the organization and the federal government. And there actually will be privacy protections and security agreements that they need to sign and adhere to in order to receive the funds to become a navigator. If you want to become a certified application counselor, which is we hope many organizations that are part of this discussion will become, there are security agreements that they and privacy protections that they also need to agree to. And it's important to note that our website will provide the general public information about navigators, certified application counselors, people we have designated to be trusted resources, people that we've already gone through the process to make sure that they have experience handling personally identifiable information. They have experience working with diverse communities so that people can know that this list of organizations is sanctified by the, endorsed by the federal government, so that you can rest assured that someone has done that digging for you and is ensuring that your information is protected. By all means, it's gonna happen. There are awful people out there that want to take advantage of people's personally identifiable information, but we're ensuring that we are working with the organizations that we trust that want to reach communities and ensure that their information is protected to the best extent possible.
And my concern really isn't even necessarily about the people that are contracted on behalf of the Navigator programs. It really is just the reality is that there will be people that are preying mm-hmm. on this opportunity. It's no different than when we do the census program.
Absolutely.
I know what a census person looks like and I'm looking for their credentials, but I don't necessarily think that is the truth across the Latino community in some communities. So, I guess my question is that what is the federal government doing in those federal mandates, in the federal system states that is going to protect the community at large from people that are representing themselves to be navigators and are serving their own interest, not just collecting private information, but are registering people for benefits or insurance programs without really presenting the breadth of what is available to them, but what's in their interest.
Yeah.
That's a very real possibility in
definitely.
Any community.
Right, and I think it's a situation you have to closely monitor going forward so that we can be informed by our community partners to see if it's happening, if it's going on, and what we can do as a federal government to ensure that that's handled. And in addition, engaging Spanish media, engaging community partners so that the information, correct information, is shared with the general public and that they can be informed consumers moving forward.
Hi, I'm Roy Cosmet from Articles Communications in New York, and also kind of on the same topic in terms of the readiness of the federally operated health marketplaces versus the state health marketplaces. In New York, there was a report in the Times this week that the marketplace there is, the health exchange is actually doing very well, and they're projecting a 50% reduction in the cost of health insurance for individuals and that will be taking advantage of that opportunity. But there was in the same report, I believe, a statement that maybe the federally operated marketplaces wasn't as far along in development, and there may not be as much competition amongst the plans that are going to be offered in the federally qualified exchange versus a state exchange like New York, where there apparently has breeded a lot of competition, and which is causing that reduction in cost. So I was just wondering, how are those states going to fare in terms of that health equity issue, you know, and please clarify if it is further along than that report might have stated.
Definitely. So you are correct, Roy, that, you know, we got very promising numbers from the state of New York this week, very similar to California and Vermont and other state-based marketplaces that have released projections of what the cost of insurance will be come the new marketplace in October. It's exciting news to hear. But what you didn't see in the New York Times article was that this week, the Department of Health and Human Services also released a report that analyzes some of the numbers. And we estimate that the individual premiums in the marketplace will be about 18% lower than we had originally predicted by the Congressional Budget Office. The opportunity to have competition in these marketplaces, competing for your business, is a better deal for consumers. We will see prices go down because we will have more healthy people part of the pool. We'll have sick people that will have access to coverage, but being able to spread that risk is showing promising opportunities for the future. And again, it's this opportunity to have competition in states where prior to the Affordable Care Act, maybe one or two companies controlled 50 to 60% of the private insurance market. Now, with this opportunity to sell their products in a marketplace, they have that much more access to consumers, and consumers reap the benefits of competition.
Thank you so much. We have time for, I believe, one more question. I see two hands, so we'll take two if they're quick.
Hi, I'm Dharma Cortez, Northeastern University in Boston. I have two questions. Moving forward, what are the federal government's plans in terms of evaluating best practices, and to what extent there is a plan to document all those best practices so we don't have to go around reinventing the wheel as we get into the enrollment and outreach process for the Latino community? The other piece is to what extent the plans in terms of how to inform the community about how to go about enrollment is also informed by the experience in Massachusetts that has had health insurance reform for about 6 years.
Sure. Do you want to start? You want? Okay. So lessons learned is critical to our efforts moving forward. I think even before the Affordable Care Act, I would hope that our lessons learned helps us create stronger programs. And we are doing just that. I mean, we have valuable lessons to learn from Medicaid and CHIP enrollment programs that we've been able to embark on, obviously since the enactment of the CHIP program in 97, but more recently with the reauthorization in 2009, they created more robust outreach and enrollment programs to try and reach children who are historically been uninsured. But also with that, we have very valuable lessons to learn from Medicare Part D. And that was a brand new program. Seniors were very skeptical of it originally. They were overwhelmed with all of these options for Part D plans and if they needed it or if they didn't. And how can we learn lessons from those efforts to ensure that moving forward with the marketplace, we're as strong as possible. When it comes to Massachusetts, we often point to Massachusetts as an example from where we can learn our lessons. You know, one of the biggest concerns was folks was the responsibility requirement and the idea that people would rather pay a responsibility requirement than have to go through the trouble of applying for insurance coverage. And we point time and time again to the state of Massachusetts, who had a very small responsibility requirement. And frankly, you did not see people paying that penalty. You saw people taking advantage of the opportunity to enroll in coverage, to have a marketplace that presents the information in a clear to understand format because they wanted health insurance. They understand how important it is to stay healthy, be productive in the workforce, be good students, and we're grateful that Massachusetts can do that. In addition, a number of academics and community organizations have presented white papers and different studies saying what type of outreach and enrollment efforts are most effective in diverse communities or in rural areas, and we absolutely can learn from those efforts moving forward. I'll definitely add, I'm sure the panel can add much more.
I think it's a testament to the great integrity and wisdom of this panel that we still have quite a few more questions in the audience, but we are running short on time, and we do want to be respectful of our panel presenters this morning. So with that, I think we do have one quick question in the back, and if we can be brief, I'll try to squeeze in one more, and then we're going to need to break for lunch. Thank you.
My name is Lori Andrews from San Diego at the San Ysidro Health Center. Mine is more of a comment. I think we have to, as a lot of you mentioned, cultural competency, that we have to be mindful and aware of what that exactly means. Being part of a cultural competency team down in San Diego County, we found it took us years to develop a cultural competency academy. Mm-hmm. And also found it very difficult to find ways to actually evaluate, you know, whether or not the people were culturally proficient, and identify tools that would create that. And we also have to be aware that we shouldn't just assume because people are from the community and we're hiring from the community that they're culturally competent. And so I would be interested in the future to see tools or best practices to make sure that we're doing those evaluations and providing support to our promotores in that area. Thank you.
Go ahead. It's a really important point to talk about not just what is cultural competency, but how do you actually implement it, how do you evaluate it, and what are the measures to evaluate it and actually see the impact, both the short-term impacts and the longer-term impacts of obviously wanting to see better health outcomes. With the release of the updated national standards for culturally and linguistically appropriate services in health and healthcare, the class standards, there are resources that come with that. So the Office of Minority Health, our office, has the Think Cultural Health website, which I hope that you have visited. If you haven't, I encourage you to visit that website. It's thinkculturalhealth, all one word, .hhs.gov. And that is our online clearinghouse of information on cultural and linguistic competency. With the release of the new standards, what came along with that is a blueprint for advancing and sustaining class into our programs and policies. And in that, it goes through each of the 15 standards, the standards that relate to communication and language assistance, that relate to governance and leadership, that relate to continuous improvement, quality assessments and evaluation, that it goes through each of those standards and provides strategies on how to implement them. It cites promising models and practices. It also has extensive bibliographies so that those who are trying to do this for the first time don't have to reinvent the wheel. Those that have already been engaged in cultural linguistic competency can see some of the new emerging practices, and that blueprint is available online for free. We also have continuing education programs, online e-learning curriculum that are available for providers that they can take that curricula, again, a free online curricula, and be able to also get continuing education credits. And in addition to that, on that website, we have an Ask the Expert where that can be that exchange and that dialogue to ask questions, to say this is what we're dealing with in our local community or in our state. And we can assist in providing that type of service and assistance to those that need it. We are certainly working with partners, with academic partners, with state and local partners, community-based organizations and the like, also accrediting organizations and many others to talk about how we measure cultural competency, how we evaluate it over the long term. But this is such a critical area. And the class standards were really enhanced because we recognized that the growing diversity of the population, and diversity in so many regards, the growing diversity of the population, the growth of the field of cultural competency, and then this moment certainly with the Affordable Care Act and recognizing how it also highlights and emphasizes the importance of cultural competency that these class standards really help to strengthen that implementation. So there's truly this synergy, as you can see, of all of these areas for us as we really work to advance health equity.
One more really, really quick one.
And actually, my question dovetails perfectly. So we were talking a lot about, my name is Laila Suleiman Gonzalez. I'm the director of the Latino Family Commission in the state of Illinois. So we've been talking a lot about getting people in the door. Once they come in the door, how would you be looking at the class standards in terms of healthcare provision and any kind of compliance reviews? And that's on the cultural competence side, because you know, if you're culturally incompetent, nothing really happens to you. But on the language access side, we do have a civil right, Title VI, compliance. So what are you doing also to sort of strengthen the compliance part of the healthcare provision, not just the, you know, getting people in the door? Thank you.
When we actually released the enhanced standards, we did that in partnership with several of our sister agencies within Health and Human Services, as well as our partners across the country. But to address your specific question, one of our key partners is the Office for Civil Rights that is led by Leon Rodriguez, who I believe spoke at last year's NCLR convention and is well known to this group. We understand the connection certainly between health disparities, health equity, and civil rights. And so under Leon's leadership and in our collaboration, he has also looked to, and the Office for Civil Rights has looked to, the enhanced class standards as a tool as they engage in their civil rights enforcement work. So certainly as they are the stewards for ensuring compliance with Title VI of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, some of the ways in which the civil rights team is looking at this is that when they do, for example, resolution agreements with healthcare delivery systems, hospitals, et cetera, that as they indicate the type of guidance that an institution needs to undertake to correct those measures, that the enhanced class standards will be a part of that. And not just the language access measures, but the entire set of the class standards, recognizing the importance of governance and leadership, recognizing the importance broadly of how you engage with the communities that you're actually serving. We also, in releasing the enhanced standards, had at the table the American Hospital Association, where the president of the American Hospital Association, Rich Umdenstock, spoke very passionately about how this was such a critical issue, that hospitals really do need to provide culturally and linguistically appropriate care to provide the best care, the highest quality of care. And so through entities such as AHA, they are also recognizing the importance of advancing and implementing class standards, culturally and linguistically appropriate services, really to be able to meet the needs of the communities that they serve. So with these enhanced standards, we are looking to these types of systematic implementations through policy, through programs, through changes in organizations that will really lead to a benefit for all. Because again, as I articulated earlier, the culture is language, it's race, ethnicity, but it's so many other things. It's our faith. How does our faith relate to how we then think about our health? How does someone who is disabled interact with the healthcare system? So it's so many different ways in which we need to be thinking about culture and language and its influence on health.
We thank all of you so much for joining us today. This is such an informative morning, and I just wanted to thank Dr. Gracia, Ms. Alvarez, Ms. Rodriguez for joining us from Health and Human Services for your information and resource referrals. I think we'll all be looking at that as we go forward through the rest of this day and through the rest of this week and into 2014. We thank Ms. McDonald for your comments and the sneak preview from Planned Parenthood and what your activities are involving. And as always, we thank Ms. Gadep Alejandra, so you know it's Alejandra, for joining us. Your wisdom, as always, with NCLR is invaluable. Thank you again, everyone, and let's break for lunch. We look forward to an informative afternoon as well. Thank you.